This is what I'm going to do. Five big topics. The first one is I'll explain to you the rise of violence in Indonesia, and then I'll frame the violence in terms of the temporal and spatial perspective. And then I'll show you the decline, and then showing you the shifting pattern of violence in Indonesia, and then how should we understand the remaining low level of violence in Indonesia still occurring today, say the rise of intolerance, the recurrence of ethnic violence, but not like the scale of ethnic violence in Ambon that we saw 1.5 decade ago. So now the first one, the rise of violence and democratization. So I'm linking the peak of collective violence in Indonesia 15 years ago with the event of democratic transition in Indonesia. And at that time, you know that democratic transitions was complemented by another big reforms, which is the decentralizations. So you can combine those two. So here I am trying to show you the temporal perspective of the peak of collective violence in Indonesia. Okay, I'm referring to the last round of the peak of violence in Indonesia with the fall of Suharto and then the following democratic transitions. This was the peak of violence that you saw, referring to the last big wave of social violence in Indonesia. And if you think of before that one, you can see here the events in Indonesia around 65. That's the previous round of very serious collective violence in Indonesia. And then we have the democratic consolidations. Then, if you want more extended data after 2003, 2005, you have this one. So you can see the concentrations of the peak of collective violence in Indonesia around between 1999 till, say, 2005. And beyond that one, you see the steep decline and stay at the very low level compared to the previous one. So we'll explain how to understand the remaining low-level violence. So this is the increase of violence. So if you want to have a kind of taxonomy of collective violence in Indonesia, we can divide them into two big categories. The first one is the episodic violence. Episodic means concentrated in terms of geography and in terms of time. Then you have the routine one. Routine means there is no geographical concentrations and without any time concentrations, spread all over the place and all over the time. We call it routine. So the episodic one consists of two main things, the secessionist violence and the ethnic violence. Very clear. Now, how should we explain the temporal and spatial nature of the peak of collective violence in Indonesia? Let's start with the first one, the temporal one. You can see the coincidence between the peak of the collective violence with the period of democratic transitions. When you are talking about the transitions, that will include the economic dimension. So economics and politics are two inseparable things. So you have to combine politics and economics. Politics will be useless without considering the economy. The economy will be very dry, will be very uncontextual if you don't consider the politics. So, okay, let's understand the peak of the collective violence in Indonesia from the temporal perspective. At least I can show you three groups of references. The first one is the global study linking the level of democracy and violence. So if you have full autocracy on the left, full democracy on the right, and you have in between the hybrid or transition regime, and you will find countries experiencing in the period of transitions from full autocracy to full democracy, you cannot jump straight away from full autocracy to full democracy. You have to go through the middle path. And in most cases, from the cross-country study, you will find that the level of violence are associated with the middle path of the democracy spectrum. So that's one argument. The second argument is about the critical juncture. What are the critical juncture? The transition can be understood as when you are moving from the previously settled rule of the game, Now you are trying to introduce the new rule of the game. You are leaving the previous one, but you are not having a settled new rule of the game. You have to transform. So in between, you see that things are not clear. You are not sure what you will get. Everybody was confused. So this is a critical juncture. So within the critical juncture, you can expect anomaly. That's the second one. And then the third one, during the transitions from autocracy to democracy, from centralized governance into decentralized governance, the so-called boundaries. Who gets what? What is the rule of the game? You are not sure about what you will get, what you will lose because of the change. So the boundary, this is the imaginary concept, right? The boundaries were being renegotiated. And when things are being renegotiated, you are part of that one. You will be affected by the new boundaries that will be set. You are interested to influence the boundary for your own benefit. The second one, decentralizations. I'm putting two arguments here. Decentralizations can be the force that dampen the flames of conflict, or decentralizations can be the medicine, can be the remedy for social violence. So there are two possibilities. The first one, if you think of the basic design of the decentralizations, you know that the idea was to calm the few aggressive regions. Who are the aggressive regions? Aceh, Papua, Riau, and East Kalimantan. They are rich and they want to control their richness. So that's the quick response from Habibie's administrations at that time to give them more fiscal power, fiscal and administrative power. So the basic design was to dampen the flames. The second one, in terms of the ethnic conflict, you can see that one of the effects of the decentralizations was to create new regions. Creating new regions means creating new posts, new bupatis, new wali kota, new members of the parliament. Then, if you're unhappy before, then you can be made happy by the change. It's dampening. And then, again, direct pilkada as the peak of political decentralizations, if you like, you can see there. The direct pilkada provided the venue for inter-ethnic and inter-religious coalitions. They are not fighting anymore. They are collaborating. So if you go to Maluku, Ambon, for example, impossible for you to win if you are the Christian candidate for wali kota and you are choosing another Christian candidate for your vice mayor. You'll not win the elections. Or if you are the Muslim candidate for the wali kota of Ambon and you are choosing another Muslim candidate for your deputy, you're not going to win the. So they know that how to play the game. So for the routine violence, there is a negative correlation between the increased fiscal power of districts in Java and the level of routine violence. That's the empirical findings. The formula is the same, but the effect of on each and every district are different. So we measure the different effects of fiscal decentralizations on the fiscal power of district in Java, and we can see the negative correlations between the increased fiscal power at the district level with the level of routine violence. So from that perspective, we conclude that there was an additional and unanticipated benefit of decentralizations with respect to routine violence. Okay, fueling the fire. The first one, decentralizations was the moment of opportunity. And everyone wants to grab that opportunity for their interest or for their group interest. And one way to grab that opportunity was through violence. Because the peaceful mechanism of competing for the future benefit were not settled yet. So before the new things were settled, you try to influence the outcome of the change through violence. So you can understand the explosions of Muslim-Christian violence in Ambon from that perspective. The second one, Claire Smith says that the major episode of ethnic conflicts were rooted in the competitions of local elites to control the state at the local level. But once the rules of the game are settled, you are still competing. Don't you think that the Muslim in Maluku and the Christians are always fight for the economic and political benefit? They always fight. Not only now, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago. So nothing wrong with fighting, as long as you have the rule of the game to fight. So there are two kinds of fighting. One is the peaceful fighting. You compete. We call it compete. And you have rule of the game. And you follow the rule of the game. So from here, from this kind of explanations, you need to understand the local democracy is a kind of the new avenue for institutionalized and peaceful conflict resolutions. Okay, now what about the spatial? Spatial means you exploit the differences between one region to other regions. Two things are important here. One is the findings on the relative deprivations, where the ethnic conflict were high in the region, where the level of education was relatively high, but at the same time, that region were also relatively much poorer. And then the second explanation was horizontal inequality. In the context of routine violence, two findings are important. One is the violence are correlated with poverty and low level of development and higher inequality. Okay, how you explain the decline? This is a very simple logic. And by international standard, the decline of collective violence in Indonesia was relatively quick. If you compare Indonesia with the Middle Eastern countries, with South Asian countries, with many African countries, the decline of social violence in Indonesia from the peak during the democratic transitions was relatively quick. So we should be happy with this one. Yeah? So the question now is how to explain the decline. Now, let's go back to the two main category of social violence, if you like. One is the violence because of the secessionist movements in several regions, say Aceh and Papua, including Riau and East Kalimantan. And then the ethnic conflict, say between religion, between ethnic, whatever. Only a few cases, by the way, not all over Indonesia. Violence or fighting is basically non-cooperative behavior. You interact, but you don't cooperate. You want to gain something out of the battle. So, but the question now is, if you don't cooperate, you will lose, and no one will gain. Both sides will lose if they keep fighting. And they experience the lose and lose situations. And you learn from the lose and lose situations. Okay? There's no gain of fighting. Let's cooperate. By cooperating, both of us will be better off. So here we are talking about the move from conflict to cooperations. Decentralizations and democratizations facilitate. So the point here is the cooperations is facilitated by the democratic consolidations. Okay, how to understand the situations in Indonesia before 1998 and the situations in Indonesia now? So you need to understand two kinds of social contract. The previous one, during Suharto, we had social contract. But the nature of that contract was vertical. You surrender your freedom to me, you will have no freedom, but in return, I will provide you with stability. So what is the horizontal social contract? So the nature is horizontal and you need consensus. And of course, consensus is expensive, consensus is long to achieve, and somehow you never get any agreement. So that's what we are experiencing now. Okay, this is the more recent data from 2005, when you see the decline, and 2012. If before, the dominant forms of collective violence in Indonesia was in the form of secessionist violence and ethnic violence, now you see that those two kinds of violence were very minimal. What is the dominant forms? The routine violence. And you can see the routine one, more or less stable all over the time. And if you want to see the distributions spread quite evenly across regions, there is no time and geographical concentration. And this is in terms of the number of casualties. So if the violence is observed because of that cleavage, we categorize that one as ethnic violence. But if you can't identify the ethnic dimensions, religious dimension, sectarian dimensions, they will fall into the routine. So routine here basically is residual. That's the way, the current approach to classifying collective violence in Indonesia. Okay, how should we understand post-2005 low level of violence? Inequality leads to violence. Poverty and lack of development are still relevant. And post-2005 ethnic violence shares the characteristics of routine violence. So ethnic violence are becoming more routine rather than more episodic. So here, this is the argument. If you address these two issues, that will have the violence-reducing effect. Vertical inequality is inequality between individuals. Say, if there are 100 people here, I'll put you from the left, from the highest income, the second highest income, to the lowest income. And then I measure the dispersion of income. That's vertical inequality. But now, I divide you with gender. This is male and female. And then I measure the average income of the male and average income of female. And then I can see the gap. So the gap is, we call it horizontal inequality, because you group people and then you see the gap. That's horizontal inequality. So here, horizontal inequality means inequality, say, between Muslim and Christian in Ambon, inequality between Dayak and Maduris, or Dayak and Malay in Kalimantan, or inequality between the Chinese Indonesian and Native Indonesian, for example, or Japanese Indonesian. So something like that. Inequality attached to the group differences. That's what we call horizontal inequality. But this cannot explain the ethnic violence. So to explain the remaining ethnic violence in Indonesia, I think you need the next argument. The problem with the illiberal democracy and new ethnic violence. So the argument was, because of the imperfectness of the current Indonesia's democracy, the current Indonesian democracy is still with the characteristic of the illiberalism rather than liberal democracy. And because of the illiberal element within the practice of democracy in Indonesia, especially at the local level, instead of using the public goods arguments, you are using the ethnicity instrument to achieve your political goal. So you use the cards of ethnic violence for electoral gains. Unfortunately, this kind of incident never reached escalated level, not as being escalated like what we saw before, because it's localized and very short-term kind of, and Indonesia also learned from that kind of things, because we have the rule of the game, and that can quish, that can disappear very quickly. And then this one, the explanation. So to understand the post-conflict violence, I mean, post-conflict means the post-big wave of ethnic violence in Indonesia, and you can see the recurrence of another ethnic violence after the big wave. You can understand here violence as a strategy when the situation permits. When you have the conflict entrepreneur, when you have the support of local elites, and when you have the negligence of the central government, and you can expect the new one will happen. But the last variable is now disappeared. Now you don't have the negligent central government. Now the central government will not tolerate any kinds of ethnic violence, for example. But you may have the interested local elites and the availability of conflict entrepreneurs. So you need the kind of combinations. So where are your religious sentiment? your ethnic sentiment. They are used as the instrument. So if you are thinking of policy, if you are thinking of what can be done, you need to use the rational choice framework. If you stick to the primordialist understanding, you will not go anywhere. According to the primordialist sentiment, the ethnic conflict were because of they hate each other. Because they have the long history of hostility, for example. Or they have different culture, which are not compatible with one another. What kind of policy that you can do to calm your hatred? Nothing. What kind of policy that you can do to rewrite the history? Nothing. What kind of thing that you can do to make the culture compatible? Nothing. So if you stick to the primordialist understanding of conflict, you will end up with nothing can be done. But if you shift your framework, you will see different avenues that you can do to solve the problem. So that will create more optimism, if you like. So this is the how should Indonesia deals with the remaining low-level violence. One is this country needs to continue the development progress, but the progress should be shared. But the problem is Indonesia is you have seen that in the past 15 years, the level of economic inequality in Indonesia has been on the rise. This is the challenge. And this regime, this administration, after the fall of Suharto, was the first president that has specific target to reduce inequality by the end of his term. So what you saw during the Yudhoyono's administrations, during the 10 years, the level of inequality increased by 30% or 60% depends on what kind of inequality measures that you are going to use. So that's something, the first one. The second one, Indonesia needs to further consolidate its democracy to remove the elements of illiberalism within the democracy. That's all.